Dear students, here we see how to do the experiment to find out the percentage of copper in the given brass sample. All of you know that brass is an alloy of copper. It is a homogeneous mixture of mainly copper and zinc. Generally, any brass sample contains copper in the range of 60% to 80% and zinc in the range of 20% to 40%. Depending upon the percentage of the copper present in the given brass sample, its properties will be decided, like malleability, ductility, and other properties. That's the reason to have an idea about the quality of the brass. What we do is we try to find out the percentage of copper present in the given brass sample. Here is a simple most experiment to find out the percentage of copper given in the brass sample. Here what we do is we will provide you with the brass solution. Instead of giving you the piece of brass, we will prepare the brass solution and we will provide you the brass solution. The first step of the experiment is preparation of 250 cm cube of the brass solution. For that matter, brass solution will be given to you, that is concentrated brass solution, that you have to make it up to 250 cm cube. That means every one of you, we will be giving you certain known amount of the brass solution. One of you may be given with 10 ml of brass solution, one more of you may be given with 12 ml of brass solution, and so on. So first step, what you have to do is you have to wash the apparatus as usual. Then you have to take the volumetric flask, and in the volumetric flask we will give you certain fixed amount of the brass solution. For example, 10 ml, let's say 10 ml of the brass solution you take into the volumetric flask, come back to your place, then add water up to the mark and close the lid and shake it for uniform concentration. This is how, by taking certain known amount of the concentrated brass solution, we are diluting it up to 250 cm cube. This is how we are preparing 250 cm cube of the brass solution. You can see here slightly bluish in color because the copper salts are generally blue in color. So I already prepared the solution here. So how to prepare the solution? You will be taking certain fixed amount of the brass solution into the volumetric flask, then adding water up to the mark, closing the lid and shaking for uniform concentration. This is part first of the experiment. Only two parts are there in the experiment. So once it is being done, what you have to do is you have to pipette out 25 ml of the brass solution into a clean conical flask. In order to do this, first you rinse the pipette with water. This pipette is already rinsed with water. Then you rinse the pipette with the brass solution. Take small quantity of the brass solution, rinse it. Okay, rinse it. Then you pipette out 25 ml of the brass solution into a clean conical flask. Into a clean conical flask. Okay, 25 ml of the brass solution into a clean conical flask. Okay, and here in this experiment you will be given with standard solution of sodium thiosulfate. Its normality is 0.01. We ourselves prepare the standard solution of sodium thiosulfate. Its normality is 0.01. What you have to do is you have to wash the burette with water anyway. Then you rinse the burette with the sodium thiosulfate solution and you fill the burette with sodium thiosulfate solution. This burette is already filled with the sodium thiosulfate solution. So one more step is filling the burette with the given standard solution of sodium thiosulfate. So part first is preparation of 250 cm cube of the brass solution. Then from that, in the second part, you pipette out 25 ml of the brass solution into a clean conical flask. To this brass solution, what you have to do is, it's very simple. The concept is very simple. What is this concept? This brass solution contains in the form of copper ions, Cu2 plus ions. This brass solution contains copper in the copper 2 plus ions, because whenever we dissolve the brass sample by adding nitric acid, what happens is copper present in the brass will interact with the nitric acid, thereby it gets dissolved, and there copper atoms present in the brass sample become copper ions. Therefore, the brass solution contains copper in the form of copper 2 plus ions or cupric ions. Okay. And how many copper ions are there? That is depending upon the percentage of copper present in the original brass solution. cleared. No. So therefore, the percentage of copper, more is the percentage of copper present in the given brass solution, more will be the number of copper ions here. And these copper ions are oxidizing in nature. Therefore, what happens? If you add one test tube of potassium iodide solution into this brass solution, the copper ions present here will oxidize the potassium iodide into iodine, will oxidize the potassium iodide into iodine. That liberated iodine we will titrate against sodium thiosulfate. Okay. This sodium thiosulfate will reduce iodine back into sodium iodide. Cleared? No. So therefore the concept is what? The concept is more is the percentage of copper in the given brass sample, more will be the number of copper ions in the respective brass solution, because we are converting all copper atoms into copper ions. More is the number of copper ions in the brass solution, more iodine will be liberated upon the addition of potassium iodide. More is the liberation of iodine, more sodium thiosulfate is required to reduce the liberated iodine. Therefore, the concept is the percentage of copper present in the given brass sample is directly proportional to the volume of the sodium thiosulfate consumed during the course of titration. Other way around, less is the percentage of copper, less will be the number of copper ions. If less is the number of copper ions, less will be the liberation of iodine upon the addition of Ki. Less is the liberation of iodine, less amount of potassium, sodium thiosulfate is consumed. This is the concept. So therefore, after pipetting out 25 ml of the brass solution, we need to add potassium iodide, right? But here is a small thing you have to observe. The thing is, while preparing the brass solution, as I told you, we add concentrated nitric acid. Therefore, while in order to ensure the complete dissolution, we add bit excess of few more drops of nitric acid. That excess nitric acid will be still there in the solution. Nitric acid is also a powerful oxidizing agent. Therefore, what happens? In this condition, if you add potassium iodide, the copper ions will oxidize potassium iodide into iodine, and the nitric acid will oxidize iodine further to iodic acid. Therefore, some iodine will be lost. Thereby, we will be ending up with wrong result. That's the reason before we add potassium iodide into the brass solution, we have to remove or neutralize that excess of nitric acid. That's the reason. Pipette out 25 ml of the brass solution. To this, you add few drops of ammonia, drop by drop. You add ammonia drop by drop till you get a blue precipitate. You add ammonia drop by drop till you get a blue precipitate. The formation of blue precipitate is the indication that all the nitric acid is neutralized. Because when you add ammonia, ammonia react with copper forming cupramonium ions. Ammonia first neutralize the nitric acid. Once all the nitric acid is neutralized, next two drops of ammonia, whatever you add, that will react with copper ions forming cupramonium ions. The color, blue color, is due to those cupramonium ions. Therefore, the formation of blue color is the indication that all the nitric acid is neutralized. Now, the solution is basic in condition, right? But iodometric titration, whenever you titrate iodine against sodium thiosulfate, the solution condition must be acidic. That's the reason we have to maintain the acidic condition, we have to add acetic acid. Acetic acid you add till this blue color, disappears, then you add excess of acetic acid. So while adding acetic acid, you can be lavish, you can add 30-40 drops of the acetic acid, thereby to maintain the acidic condition properly. So now, what has happened? You took the brass solution 25 cm cube and you neutralized whatever the excess of nitric acid was there, and you also maintained the acidic condition by adding acetic acid. So I repeat the things. In the titration part, pipette out 25 ml of the brass solution. To that, you add ammonia drop by drop till you get blue color. Then you add acetic acid in excess, thereby to maintain the acidic condition. Now to this, you add one test tube of potassium iodide. When you add potassium iodide, as I told you, copper ions present here will oxidize potassium iodide into iodine. That you can observe. See here, that you can absorb by the formation of yellowish color. The reason is the iodine is a dark brown colored compound. Because we diluted the brass solution here, you are getting a dark yellowish kind of the color. That's the indication that you are getting the liberation of iodine. This liberated iodine, you titrate against sodium thiosulfate taken in the burette. So this sodium thiosulfate taken in the burette, when you add this, what happens is sodium thiosulfate reduces iodine to sodium iodide, and itself get oxidized to sodium tetrathionate. So therefore, when you keep on adding sodium thiosulfate, more and more iodine will be reduced to sodium iodide. Therefore, gradually the concentration of iodine decreases. When the concentration of iodine decreases, you can see the yellow color will become lighter. Brown become yellow, dark yellow, lighter yellow, very lighter yellow, etc. When it becomes pale yellow, when the color becomes pale yellow, that is very light yellow, you add 8 to 10 drops of the starch indicator. When you add starch indicator, you can observe there is a formation of blue color. When you add 8 to 10 drops of starch indicator, you can observe there is a formation of blue color. The reason is starch forms a complex. Starch forms a unstable complex with the iodine. The color of that complex is dark blue. Okay. Now you continue the titration till the blue color disappears. You continue the titration till the blue color disappears. So the disappearance of blue color, see, look at this, blue color is immediately disappeared. The disappearance of blue color is the end point. For example, I got the end point somewhere around 3 or 4 mL. So in this way, you do 3 trials. Out of 3 trials, you take the least value to calculate it further. And here you may get a question that in the case of all the other experiments, we add indicator in the beginning. Only in the case of this titration, our iodometric titration, we are adding starch near the end point. Whenever the color becomes pale yellow, we are adding the starch indicator. The reason is, in the beginning when you add starch, in the beginning there is a higher concentration of iodine, right? Under higher concentration of iodine, if you add starch, starch forms a stable complex. Then, because it is stable, the blue color will not be disappeared even when the end point is reached. That's the reason we have to add starch near the end point where iodine concentration is lesser. And under lower concentration of iodine, starch forms an unstable complex. Therefore, once the end point is reached, blue color will be disappeared. Disappearance of blue color is the end point. By any chance, if sometime blue color is reappeared, this is because we not added enough amount of the acetic acid. In that case, you add few more drops of sodium thiosulfate till the blue color disappears. So this is how you can do this experiment. So part first is what? Taking fixed amount of the brass solution, adding water up to the mark, closing the lid, shaking for uniform concentration. Then filling the burette with sodium thiosulfate. Then second part, pipette out 25 ml of the brass solution to a conical flask. To that you are adding drop by drop ammonia till you get blue color. Then you are adding excess of acetic acid to maintain the acidic condition. Then to that you are adding 1 test tube of potassium iodide. You will be getting yellow color. Titrate against sodium thiosulfate slowly till the yellow becomes very pale yellow or light yellow. Once it becomes light yellow, add 8 to 10 drops of the starch. You get blue color. Continue the titration till the blue color disappears. This is how you can do this experiment. Once we get the value, we can do the calculation very much easily to find out the percentage of copper in the given sample of brass solution.